President Muhammadu Buhari received briefing from the chairman of the Presidential Task Force on COVID-19, Boss Mustapha, on the activities of the PTF across the country. Speaking to the State House correspondent on the outcome of the closed-door meeting, Mustapha said they briefed the president on the activities and overall positions of the Presidential Task Force on COVID-19. The chairman of the task force said it was part of a routine exercise and the third time an interim report and update had been submitted to the president. We're reminded by Boss Mustapha that since the presidential address to the nation on the easing of the lockdown to date, 13 days had passed. He said we should expect new processes to be put in place from today. President Buhari had on Sunday received the Madagascar Native Formulation Against the COVID-19 Pandemic from the president of Guinea-Bissau, Umaru Sissoco Embalo, who was on official visit to Nigeria. President Buhari assured that he would listen to science before allowing traditional or any new medicines to be administered on Nigerians. And joining us now from Jos is Dr. Ferdinand Ogbaji, who is a resident doctor, Community Health Department, Jos University Teaching Hospital. Good morning, Dr. Ferdinand.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us this morning also. Now, so much is in flux and yet the numbers keep coming in. How do we respond to the steady count in infections? Is it solely to be seen as bad news?
Well, definitely not. We won't be quick to say that it's bad news. I've seen a steady rise in infection. The fact is that if you test, you will find them. Even though there are speculations that there's a lot of infections in the community, it goes beyond just that. If you test, you will definitely find. So the more increase in tests we have, we'll find those cases. In fact, you might even argue and say that it's good that we're finding these cases because they are actually out there already. Mm-hmm. So once we find the positive cases, we do the necessary isolate and treat, or if they're negative, we can exclude them from our list of suspicions. So the fact that we're seeing rise in the number of cases doesn't necessarily mean that it's a bad news.
All right. Would you say that the higher the figures, the more believable they are?
No, not necessarily. The fact that you have to compare the number you're having or the positive cases to the number of tests you are doing. For example, if you do 100 tests and you get 20 cases, and then the next day you say you have 3 cases, you need to tell us how many tests you have done for you to get 3 cases so that we can compare both of them. Until you can demonstrate a steady decline, reduction in positive cases compared to the number of tests you are doing, a given specific number of tests, then you can say that there's a reduction. Mm-hmm. So we shouldn't say that once the test is higher, then we believe the results. Of course, there's a lot of people complaining that maybe governments are trying to hide the cases or some states are not reporting, but it's not necessary. You need to compare the positive cases with the number of tests that we're doing. Some days you do more tests, some days you do less tests. Sometimes the tests take a while before the results come in.
All right, we also heard that, you know, at the end of last week that we should brace ourselves for a more seasonal presence of COVID-19 than we had expected. Now, how does this affect our processing of planning and prevention, you know, healthcare measures?
Yes, granted, the health professionals and scientists have been working on this, and the speculations are that, well, a couple of things can happen. We can have the COVID-19 being an endemic disease, meaning it remains with us just like you have malaria, and then there may be seasonal variations, especially during the flu season, like the speculations have been, such that during a particular period of the year, there's an increase in the number of cases, and then there are other times where there are low transmission rates. So this is a possible picture that we may have. If this is going to be the case for us as a country, it's really important for us to have our system checked. This is an opportunity for us to fix the leaking roofs in our health sector and take advantage of it and set systems in place. For example, we have a protocol for Lassa fever response, for example, because we know Lassa fever came, it hasn't gone. There's still a possibility that there are outbreaks every now and then, like we're having even in this period. So what we need to do as a nation is to harmonize our thoughts together and come up with a protocol for response for coronavirus, such that if it comes in the future, there's a task force that will be activated to handle this issue. So there's a possibility that it can remain with us. That's why the talks around the provision and development of a vaccine, which may probably be the best answer for us now if it is going to be endemic to us.
All right. As you do know, Dr. Ferdinand, Nigeria received its own portion of the formulation from Madagascar. What's your thought on that?
Well, let's not be quick to discard that. Madagascar is an interesting island. One of the interesting things about Madagascar is that it has its landscape. The island is such that there are some unique animals and plants to the island. And if you follow the news, you will notice that Madagascar have had just about 200 infections. Over 50% of those have recovered. And just recently, their first death was recorded. So let's not be quick to discard that. Having said that, the president has assured us that he's not going to just take the remedy and then just use it. There's a protocol for us in Nigeria for accepting such pharmaceutical products, and then it has to go through the validation processes. What we need to do is to ensure that the organization, the pharmaceutical industry, the NAFDAC, they do their due diligence, and then it's their responsibility to hold them accountable. You would know that a lot of herbal medications have been registered by NAFDAC. So as long as it goes through the right processes and then it passes and it is being used and it's effective, kudos for us in Africa. We should celebrate that if it works. So let's not discard it. Let's even encourage more research for us as a nationality.
Right.
See what we can. Something good can come out of Africa indeed.
All right. Away from that now, on the matter of adequate protection of the frontline healthcare workers, what do you say about the fact that the National Association of Nigerian Nurses and Midwives says that almost 1,000 nurses and midwives have been exposed to coronavirus, out of which about 250 of them are currently on isolation and about 85 out of 600 have tested positive?
I can't confirm that figure for you. However, what I can confirm is that a lot of health workers have been exposed. A lot are at risk. And the fact is that a lot have died. Even more than that have been infected. Some are on isolation. And the health workers are really on the front lines. And it can be discouraging for us. Imagine going to a war front as a soldier without being properly armed. You will definitely not be encouraged to do that. So the association probably has their figures. They have their association around the country and have their figures. But I can't confirm those specific figures. But definitely, health workers are at a loss of risk, and a lot is going on. Many have given their lives for this. So we should really take more responsibility for our health workers as a nation.
And then practically speaking, what more can we do, you know, to ensure that our generals, if you like, in this battle are equipped enough for the battle?
I think the minimum for us is adequate personal protective equipment. I think that is minimum. Yes, we've done a lot, but a whole lot still needs to be done. All we have is like a drop in the ocean to tell you what the need for us as a country and health workers are. We need to do it. The government still needs to provide health workers with personal protective equipment, at least the basic ones. And then a lot of individuals and private organizations have been doing a lot on that, even donating some of these things to those that need them. So we need to do more on that. Beyond that, as a people, we all know one or two health workers, or we are related to them. We need to encourage them.
Mm-hmm.
We need to pray for them, if not anything. And then we need to pray for them and their family and support them with encouragement so that we don't lose hope, so that people don't give up. It's a calling for many of us. They see like a full-time ministry. So we'll give our all for it. We took an oath, but you need to know that the health workers need to be alive to take care of the future of Nigerians. So we can't just throw them out into the open without arming them appropriately for that.
Mm.
So the citizens should raise their voices, talk to the public officers, talk to the government to ensure that these things are provided for our health workers.
All right, Dr. Ferdinand Obagye, our prayers are with you, and we are also sending you positive energy to please stay safe out there. Thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you so much. Pleasure is mine.